Okay, so I'm Adam, like Chris introduced. And I gave this talk at Laracon in Amsterdam, and a lot of people seemed to enjoy it, so I thought I would give it to you guys here and see what you guys thought. So I want to talk to you guys a little bit about test-driven development, some of the struggles that I kind of faced when I was trying to get into it myself, and some strategies that I've used to make it easier and solve some of the problems that I ran into. So first thing, I actually have a question for you guys. Does anybody know who this guy is?
Alan?
Hmm?
My uncle George.
Alan?
No.
No.
Alan?
No.
Okay, so this is Kent Beck, but I actually just usually refer to him as God. And these are two of his disciples, Uncle Bob and Martin Fowler. And together, these guys actually authored the 7 books of the Holy Bible of Programming. So has anybody recognized any of these books or read any of these books? Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Which ones have you read?
We have first one.
Most of them. We have the Agile, Cream Coder, Test-Driven Development. Yeah, we have most of them.
Awesome.
Cream Coder was amazing.
Cool. Cool. Yeah. So I've read most of these books. The only one that I actually haven't really got into too deeply is the Smalltalk one, because the syntax has always been a little bit foreign to me. But the first one I read was the Agile Software Development Principles, Practices, and Patterns book. And I read the C-sharp version. But at the time that I read it, I was really struggling to understand how to properly design object-oriented systems, and that like set a light bulb off my head. It was like made everything so clear, and it just made me think about things in a totally different way, and I couldn't understand how I never saw it that way in the first place. So if you are looking to read any of these books, to me that one was totally fundamental in getting me to where I am as a developer today. Aside from that, The Patterns of Enterprise Application Architecture by Martin Fowler, that introduces a lot of the awesome patterns that we use every day, like Model View Controller was first written about there. Clean Code, right, which is a great book. The Refactoring book is totally awesome. Absolutely brilliant, full of lots of cool little refactorings. Like, it's not just a book that you have to read all at once. You can just kind of go to it anytime you have a problem, different code smells, and it'll kind of give you ways to solve some of that stuff. And then the book on the end there is actually Test-Driven Development, the original Test-Driven Development book by Ken Beck, where he sort of introduces the idea of TDD. So is anyone here like not familiar with what TDD is in general? No? Everyone knows? So yeah, Ken Beck basically introduced this idea of writing your tests first and the red-green refactor cycle, right? So the whole idea is that you write your tests first and watch your tests fail, and then you write the absolute minimal simplest code that you can to make those tests pass, and then you refactor that code until you're happy with the design, all while keeping your tests green the entire time. And there's some super obvious benefits to this, right? Like, it lets you build this nice regression testing suite, so anytime you're building a new feature or deploying something to production, you can just run all your tests and make sure nothing's broken, which is the more obvious benefit that I think we can all agree on. But some people take that a little bit further and talk about how TDD can help also guide your application's design. So this whole idea of test-driven design. And if you think about that in terms of PHP, it's pretty clear, right? Anyone who's written PHP long enough has seen systems that have been built with just giant multi-thousand line PHP files, where somewhere at the top of the file, you're including a bunch of files from random places on the file system, setting up a database connection, querying the database for stuff, all while echoing HTML in the response all at the same time while iterating over database response sets and stuff. Code like that is basically impossible to test, right? So if you're forcing yourself to write your tests first, then it's impossible to end up with code that can't be tested. So on that level, I think it's pretty hard to disagree that writing your tests first is going to give you some degree of improvement to your design over something that's just a total mess. But a lot of people will actually take it to a more extreme view and say stuff like, code that's hard to test in isolation is poorly designed. So not just that writing your tests first and following TDD will help you arrive at a better design than not using TDD, but that you should isolate at all costs, and if you can't test your code in isolation and you're not testing these small, discrete little units of things, then your code is automatically garbage, and you're not doing things properly. So when I was first learning about testing and trying to get into this myself, that idea was sort of in the back of my mind the whole time. So anytime I was trying to write tests, I was always thinking about how can I make sure I'm only testing this one method on this one object and that I'm not talking to anything else. I just want to focus on this one behavior, and I have to be able to not touch the database and not talk to any other objects. And that idea was always in the back of my mind, and I was working really hard at it. But I found that I was ending up with code that I wasn't really happy with anymore, like code that I found kind of harder to understand, and also tests that I don't know if I really thought were testing what I really wanted them to test, tests that I didn't necessarily have confidence in, like pushing stuff up to production. I didn't necessarily know for sure that I had tested the right stuff because I was trying to break things down to this like super small level to the point where it was kind of harder to reason about my entire system. But I assumed that this was just because of a lack of experience and because I hadn't practiced it enough, and that the more I did it, over time, I would get better at designing my applications, I would get better at testing, my tests would get better, and my code would get better, and ultimately, I would reach that goal that everyone talks about, where you have these perfectly designed systems with perfect tests, and everything's easy to change, and anytime a customer wants to change something, it's 5 minutes, and everything's good, no problem, right? So I just assumed that I would get there eventually, and I thought, if I can't get there, then, you know, I'm just, like, not cut out for this development thing. Everyone agrees that that's the way to do it. I'll get there eventually. But then in, like, I think it was May at RailsConf, David Heinemeier Hansen, the creator of Ruby on Rails, gave this talk called Writing Software, and he said some stuff like this, that isolated testing has given birth to some truly horrendous monstrosities of architecture, a dense jungle of service objects, command patterns, and worse. And as soon as I saw him give this talk, I started thinking to myself, like, wait a minute, like, there's another side to this story. Like, I thought everyone just agreed that we have to work towards really small units and testing everything in isolation, and that was the answer. That was what good code looks like. And this guy was all of a sudden saying that there's more to it, that maybe ease of testability is not the only yardstick you should be using to measure your code quality. And a lot of the stuff he was saying like really, really resonated with me because I was finding myself running into some of these same problems. And instead of thinking that I was just... that there was something wrong with the philosophy, I thought it was just that there was something wrong with me. So hearing someone else agree with the problems I've been running into and talk about these same issues made me really start to question the practices that I was actually using and think about them more critically instead of just blindly following different things and assuming that that was the way I was supposed to do it. So what he was really saying here, right, is that there's more to good code than just ease of testability and ease of testability in isolation. So got me thinking, like, what, in my opinion, makes good code? Like, what to me is good code? So I kind of wanted to ask you guys, is there anything, any kind of principles that you guys try and follow when you're writing code, or things that you look for that make good code in your mind?
I think readability.
Readability? Yeah. Sure, absolutely.
Small functions, small procedures.
Yep, yep.
Reusable?
I would concur with readability.
Okay.
You need to be able to come back in 2 years and actually understand what you're doing.
Totally. Perfect. So, yep. Cool. Awesome. So, it's good to hear all that stuff. So I kind of landed on three things. The first one was that good code is easy to change, right? So to me, this is the idea that kind of aligns the most with things being easy to test. So this is talking about like no duplication. Like if I need to make a change in my system, I don't want to have to change it in 5 different places. That idea should just be encapsulated in one place. I can just update it there. Keeping things loosely coupled. So if I need to swap something out with a different implementation, I don't have these hard references to different parts of my application. I can just pull it out with something that does the same job in a different way. Separating my concerns so I don't have one class that renders HTML and also talks to the database because that becomes hard to maintain. You know, following things like dependency injection and stuff like that, programming to an interface. So this one I think like everyone can kind of agree on, right? From like a purely technical point of view, good code is code that's easy to maintain, easy to change, and resilient to refactorings and resilient to changes in requirements. So the second one, which a lot of you guys mentioned as well, which I'm glad to hear, is that good code should be easy to understand, right? So to me this means things like expressive names. If I have to have a method that's almost a full sentence long, I would rather, it should be a full sentence long. I want to be able to go back to it later and read that method name and be like, okay, I know exactly what that does. There's no point in like being clever or trying to abbreviate things. It doesn't help anyone. Maybe it makes the line a little bit shorter, but is that really a priority over being able to understand your code? So short methods.
Results should not be dollar R.
Exactly, exactly. That's exactly right. You shouldn't have like, you know, just variables that are just riddling off every letter in the alphabet every time you need to introduce a new variable. And I think like we can all agree on that, but I mean even past that point of just like really, really thinking about like, what is this thing? I need to be able to give this like a really good name. And naming is like the hardest thing in programming, but it's also like the most important thing. Yeah?
Has anyone here ever written COBOL?
I haven't written COBOL, no.
COBOL was written to be like the English language.
Okay.
So that when you wrote it, you literally were reading it as if you were reading prose. Right? Sometime after that, we got into other languages like
sure.
Algol and whatnot, where they were extremely cryptic.
Yeah. So somewhere we lost that original idea.
Yes, that is what kills that right off the top.
Cool.
JavaScript and even PHP makes that
yep.
difficult to do.
For sure. Yeah. So short methods. So if you have a method that's 100 lines long with a bunch of nested conditionals and loops, it's like trying to read like a choose-your-own-adventure book from start to finish, right? You have to. It's really hard to reason about what's the actual flow of this application? How many different paths can it take? How many different things can possibly happen here? It's better to extract that stuff into stuff with really good names.
So if you wrote a crazy method like that,
yep.
just to get it working,
yep.
and then you go and refactor it?
Yeah, right? That's the whole point of the refactoring step.
But say it works as like a, maybe it's a high priority to refactor it.
I would say it should be a high priority, unless it's a file that you think you're never, ever going to have to open again. But you're going to have to look at it one day. There's going to be a bug in there, and you're going to have to figure out where that bug is. Yeah, absolutely. And then the third point related to this one that is kind of like maybe the most controversial one is that easy-to-understand code also has minimal indirection. So a good example that I've used in the past that I'd like to give you guys today is in all these web apps that we build, it's very, very common for a user to have to register in your system, create a user in the database, and then send them a confirmation email, right? And one of the kind of best practices that you hear about doing this is the code that creates the user and saves it to the database that's responsible for that registration process shouldn't be responsible for sending out that email because it's a separate responsibility. So a lot of the time what we'll do is we'll fire like a user registered event or a user created event, and somewhere else in your system you'll be listening for that event and you'll send that email. So that is kind of what's encouraged as the best practice, but is that easier to understand than a controller that looks like this? User equals this create user from all the input, send them a confirmation, and then redirect to the home page. Like, this isn't necessarily a better design, but I don't think it's possible to argue that this is not easier to understand.
Yeah.
Right? It's very clear what's happening here. If you try to test this, you know that you need to somehow swap in some sort of fake mail service so you don't start sending out emails every time you run your test suite. In the other situation, where the code that sends the mail is totally decoupled and in a different part of your system and not completely obvious, some new developer who might be trying to write tests for something like that might not realize that this is firing events that other things in the application are listening for. So again, it might not be a better design, but it's definitely easier to understand. The third thing,
there's
trade-offs to everything. Everything is about trade-offs, right? The third thing is that code should be enjoyable to use if you want it to be good. And I think we're at a Laravel meetup, right? I think one of the things that draws a lot of people to Laravel is like the intuitive API and how if you want to be able to do something with a class, most of the time you can guess what the method name is going to be called and you're going to get it right. So to me, that's really important, being able to just write code that's like fun to write and like is the code that I want to write instead of something that's a little bit more cryptic. Stuff that's like more forgiving. So if you have like a date range class that takes two dates and represents the time range between those two dates, being able to pass in a date time to both parameters or a string that looks like a date or a number that represents a timestamp, that makes it easier to use. If I have anything that can represent a point in time, I can pass it into this class. It adds some internal complexity to that class because now it has to worry about translating it all into the same format, but it's way nicer to work with from the outside perspective. Convention over configuration, which is something that I think we all value as like Laravel developers as well. Like, how nice is it using an ORM like Eloquent where I can just create a class called comment and a table called comments, and the class can be empty and I can start creating comments and retrieving them from the database and set up relationships and stuff like that instead of having to create some complex YAML file or like Docker where I'm like adding annotations and defining all these properties, just all this boilerplate that shouldn't have to be there, right? So that's what makes code enjoyable to use to me. So an example, right? This is pretty clear. So imagine this is in a controller. You need to like flash a message to the session and then redirect them back to the login screen if something failed. So we tell the session to put something in the message key for just one request with this login failed message. Then we ask the redirector to return a redirect response for us to a specific URL and return that response. This is super clear and easy to understand, but is it more enjoyable to use than like something like this? Like, this is just so much nicer to write, right? This is fun to write. It's fun to write code like this. Just redirect to user login with the message login failed.
Yeah.
Like, how nice is it to write code like that, right? So the thing with these kind of three ideas is that they pull your code in different directions. So writing code that's easy to test might not be code that's easy to understand, or writing code that's easy to understand might not be code that's easy to change. So I found myself in this situation where I was wondering, how come I can't write good code? How come I can't write code that like satisfies all these principles? Why is it so hard for me to write tests when I'm trying to write code that's enjoyable to use? And I was trying to figure out what I was doing wrong. And I mean, I must have been doing something wrong. These three goals seem super reasonable to me. I shouldn't have to completely trade off how easy it should be to understand code just for the sake of testing code. That doesn't seem like a fair trade-off to me. There should be some sort of balance, right? So to get to the bottom of this, I started asking myself, like, why am I testing first in the first place? What's the reason that I want to write my tests before I write my code? And I came up with three things again. So the first one and the most important one is to enable confident refactoring. So for me, the most important part of a test suite is the ability to run all my tests before I deploy a new feature to production and be confident that if I see that green bar in my terminal, that the application works. Like, I'm writing these tests for me to give me some peace of mind. Like, that's the goal of these tests. The second thing is it helps me emphasize my public API. So when I'm running my tests first, I'm thinking of that test as almost like a sandbox or a playground for trying to figure out how I want to interact with the code that I'm about to write. And doing this first usually results in a more intuitive and enjoyable to use public API for the functionality that I'm writing than diving into the implementation first and trying to figure out how to get the rest of the system to talk to that after I've got some sort of spiked version of it working. So in my tests, I can think about, you know, what should this method be called? How many ways should there be to perform this functionality? What situations is this going to happen from? What parameters do I want to pass in? And I can set up my tests in a similar way to how something looks in my application and be like, yeah, this feels right. And by doing that first, it usually results in a better result for me. The third thing is helping identify the task at hand. So by running my tests first, I'm basically setting up what my acceptance criteria are for the feature that I'm about to work on. So I know that once my tests are green and I'm happy with the design, that the feature is done. And I always have this kind of goal to work towards. And I know that once the tests are passing, that I've implemented what I set out to implement. If I just dive into implementation first, a lot of time you kind of get lost in the weeds thinking about, you know, how else can this be used? Oh, maybe I should have this feature as well. Oh, it'd be cool if it could do this. And you can spend 3 days working on something that should have just taken an afternoon if you had that sort of finish line set up in the first place to work towards. And I started thinking, like, these things, just like the criteria that to me make good code, seem like totally reasonable things. Like, yeah, these seem like very good reasons to write my tests first. Why am I still having a hard time writing tests that I like that result in code that I like? And what I kind of landed on was that, in my opinion, isolation is overrated. So don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that you should never isolate things or that you should never use test doubles. I'm just saying that maintainability is important, but isolation for the sake of isolation is not the end goal. Isolation is a solution to another problem, but it's not the solution to every problem. So everything has trade-offs, right? And something that I found when I was first getting into testing was this whole, like, mocks are the answer to everything mentality. Or, you know, like, oh, I want to be able to test this thing that relies on this model. Oh, just mock out the database. You know, it's as easy as that, man. Just snap your fingers, mock the database, no big deal. Or just, you know, stub out this collaborator or use a test spy here or use a fake there. Just focus on the one thing that you're trying to test. You shouldn't have to care about that stuff. Why should you have to care about that stuff? Just mock it out, stub it out. That's how you write tests. And I don't think that's the right mentality. So there's trade-offs in isolating everything, just like there's trade-offs in using like an active record implementation for your ORM. Like, the trade-off that you're making when you're choosing to use active record instead of like a data mapper implementation, so when you're choosing to use Eloquent instead of using something like Doctrine, you're prioritizing simplicity and like quickness of implementation over maybe maintainability and maybe over testability. But the important thing to do is to recognize that you're making that trade-off and recognize, like, yes, I'm deciding that in this case, I'm valuing that more than I'm valuing that, and that's why I'm picking this. And it's totally valid to be able to do that. So there's actually some issues that you can run into when you over-isolate things, and I want to walk through some examples of problems that I've personally run into and strategies that I've used to mitigate this stuff. So the first pitfall of over-isolation in your tests is that you can sometimes end up with lying tests. So imagine we have this super simple application. This just represents an order that someone placed, right? And this is the whole application. It's just a screen that shows you like a receipt. And this is made up of a couple subcomponents. So you have a product, which just has a name and a price. You have like a line item or an order item, which is composed of just a product and a quantity, and it has the ability to calculate the total price for that line item. And then you have the order itself, which can tally up these order items and figure out your total price, like forget about tax or anything, right? Just something super simple. So let's look at the order item for a second here. Imagine we want to implement the ability to calculate that 750, to calculate the total price for an order item. And we want to do it using TDD, so we want to write our tests first. So we end up writing a test maybe that looks something like this. Test can get total price. Since we're only worried about testing the total price method on the order item, and we're not worried about testing how the product object works, we can create a stub of the product. It looks like we're creating a mock, but mockery just uses the word mock for everything, regardless of what role that test double is playing in your system. So we're creating a stub of the product. We're going to stub out the getPrice method and say that it should return 500 cents for the price of that product. We're going to pass that product into the order item with the quantity that we want to be associated with that order item. And then we're just going to make sure that when we ask the order item for its total price, it gives us 1,500 cents back. Super straightforward, simple test, right? So since we're doing TDD, we're going to run our tests first, and we're going to see that it fails just like we want it to. And then we can implement a basic implementation. So I have this like get product price method here that just delegates to the product to get its price. And then the get total price method just gets the product price, multiplies it by the quantity, and returns it. Run our tests again, and everything's green and everything's good. We deploy it, everyone's happy. But a few days later, your client comes to you and tells you that they want to add a feature to the system where instead of just tracking the price that they're selling their items for, they also want to track the cost that they're paying to their suppliers for these items. So now you have these kind of two concepts of cost or price in the system, and all of a sudden this like get price method that you implemented on the product seems a little bit ambiguous. Is this the price that I paid my supplier for it, or is this the price that I'm selling it to my customers for? So you want to change this up a little bit and rename this so it's a little bit more clear. So we go to the test first, and we have this test for getting a price. We just test that when we instantiate a product with its price, we can ask it for its price and get it back. Again, like the simplest test you could possibly write. We're going to update it to get selling price, because that's what we really care about now. And we're going to run these tests, and we're going to see that they fail. We're going to go to the product class. We update the get price method to be the get selling price method now, and run the tests again, and everything's good. All our tests for the whole system pass, push it up to production, ship the feature, we're happy. But then all of a sudden our client calls us 30 minutes later, the site's down, everything's broken, right? You wouldn't have this whoops thing turned on in production, of course, but this is what you see in your environment. Fatal error exception, call to undefined method product to get price. What? We renamed that to get selling price. We ran the test, everything was green, we fixed that. Well, what's the problem here? We go back to our order item class and we see we're still calling get price here. Well, why did our tests pass if this is broken? Well, it's because we used a stub for the product, and we're stubbing out the get price method, not the get selling price method. So there's an API drift that's happened here. Our test double API is no longer in sync with the actual object, right? So there's got to be a solution to this. Like, this is a ridiculous problem to have. So what's the solution? The solution in this case is to just use real collaborators. Instead of creating a stub for that product, just replace that stub with a real product. Just instantiate a product with a name and a price and pass that in instead of the stub. And now our tests fail because that real instance of that product, we're trying to call the get price method and it doesn't supply that method anymore. So now our tests are giving us the same information that the browser was giving us when we went to visit that page. So we can go and update that method to be get selling price instead. Now the tests are green and the site works. So Sandy Metz, I don't know if anyone's heard of Sandy Metz before. She's kind of a bigger name in the Ruby community. She's got a really great book called Practical Object-Oriented Design in Ruby and speaks at a lot of conferences about object-oriented design and testing and stuff. She has this quote in her book that when your tests use the same collaborators as your application, they always break when they should, and that the value of this cannot be underestimated. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that you should always, always, always use the real instance of an item instead of a test double. But in the case of that product class, it's super, super, super cheap to build, right? It doesn't have this like complex dependency tree where I have to create six objects before it to be able to instantiate that product. It's just a one-liner. So the value that you get out of using the real product instead of a test double is totally worth using the real implementation instead of the test double in that case. So the next pitfall that I want to talk about is implementation coupling. So imagine that we're testing the ability to get the total price on the entire order now instead of just an order item. And our order class, our order object, and its constructor takes a collection object that represents a collection of these order items, right? So since we just want to worry about testing the functionality of the order class and not of the collection object that we're passing in, we're going to create a test double for that collection. So we're going to create a stub of the collection. And since this collection class has this handy sum method on it, right? I don't know if anyone is intimately familiar with the public API of like the Illuminate support collection class. You can call this sum method, pass it a callback, and just return a value from that callback, and it'll tally those up the whole time. So that's what we've decided to use for our implementation. So we're going to say that this collection should respond to the sum method and return 1500, and we're going to pass that collection into the order, and we're just going to make sure that when we ask the order for its total price, that returns us the sum that we programmed into our collection stub. So we run the tests, the tests fail, and we go and implement it, right? So we have this constructor that takes the order item collection, and then we have this implementation of get total price, where we just call this item sum, create this callback that just tallies up the total price of every order item, run the tests, and everything passes. But what if, you know, going back to this, what if you didn't know about the sum method that existed on the collection object, right? You can implement the same thing with reduce, right? Which basically does the same thing, but instead of being programmed to only tally things up, you can kind of do whatever you want. So here we pass in like the sum, which is defaulted to zero as the last parameter, and that's kind of our carry value that it iterates over every time it calls this callback. And inside of it, we just return the sum plus the total price of the next order item, and that'll tally everything up and give us our sum. But maybe you don't even know about the reduce method on the collection. We've all written code that looks like this, right? We just create a result that defaults to zero at the beginning. We iterate over each item in a for each loop. We tally them up into the result, and we return that result. All three of these implementations are going to return the exact same number. But if we use this implementation, our tests fail. Why the hell should our tests fail if the implementation returns the exact same result? And obviously the answer is because we're using this test double that's only expecting to receive the sum method. So what's the solution to this? The solution to this is to use real collaborators as well, just like we did for the other one. So instead of mocking out this collection object or stubbing out this collection object, we can do something like this. It's a little bit more elaborate of a setup. We create some products, we wrap them in order items and pass that into collection, and then pass that collection into the order and check everything the same as before. But now, if we use the sum implementation, the tests pass. If we use the reduce implementation, the tests pass. If we use the for each implementation, the tests pass. So this guy, Steve Fenton, has this really great quote in a blog post he wrote about TDD that the great irony of over-isolation is that it actually makes you more dependent on implementation. So the lower level that you're trying to write these tests, the more coupled you are to the way that you're expecting your objects to communicate. So if you're expecting to have to refactor how the communication happens between several objects to accomplish some specific functionality, testing at that really microscopic level is going to prevent you from doing big refactorings, quote-unquote big refactorings, like changing sum to reduce, right? So the setup for that was a little bit more complicated, and you could probably create some, stub out some of the stuff inside that and maybe just use a real collection object instead of real products, real order items, and a real collection. But thinking about what you're expecting to refactor and what's going to change will kind of guide how you're going to decide to set up your test in the first place and what real objects you use and what test doubles you're going to use. So the third pitfall, which is kind of what DHH talked about in his keynote, if anyone has seen that, is the dreaded design damage, right? So imagine in this system that we designed, we have customer objects, and we want to be able to retrieve a customer's open orders. So we have this concept of closed orders and open orders. An open order is an order that hasn't been shipped from the warehouse yet. So it just has a null date shipped value. A closed order is an order that has been shipped from the warehouse, so it has some sort of date shipped value. Instinctively to me, the API that I would want to have available to me to retrieve these open orders is just something like this. I just want to say customer, get open orders, and I instantly have access to the open orders for that customer. So let's kind of judge this against our three criteria. Is this easy to understand? I think it's pretty easy to understand. I don't think it could be easier to understand. We have a customer and we're getting its open orders. As long as you know what open orders mean, then that line of code is pretty straightforward. Is it enjoyable to use? I would say it's enjoyable to use. If you have a customer anywhere in your system and you need to be able to retrieve the open orders for that customer for something that you're doing, you just call get open orders and you have the orders available to you. You don't have to do any kind of crazy setup or use a lot of other objects or anything. But is it easy to unit test? This one I don't really know for sure. So why don't we try writing a test and see what happens? So you might try something like this, right? Oh, I gave it away. So, so you create a mock for your order collection. You create a partial mock of the customer because you know that the open orders method actually depends on the orders relationship, but you need to stub out that orders relationship because you don't want to actually go to the database. And now you just say that the customer should receive this like chained query scope call, which you know is the implementation that returns you the unshipped orders and return what you defined as the open orders, which is just this mock collection. And then you just make sure that the results that you get back are the same. Now I gave it away, but what I was originally going to ask you guys was what you think of this test.
It tests
nothing, right? It looks really suspicious, right? Because all you're doing is duplicating what you expect the implementation to be in your test. I could say customers should receive, you know, orders where price is greater than 15. And as long as the implementation that I wrote was the same as the test, it would pass. But it doesn't actually prove that it gives me back what I actually consider the open orders to be. So that doesn't test anything. So what can we do to update our design or modify our design to make this easier to unit test in isolation? Well, one thing that we could do is we could introduce this order repository object, right? And it's a little hard to read here, but I'm going to walk through it and tell you guys about it. So we got this test that we can retrieve open orders from the order repository. So instead of using an active record implementation, we're going to use more of a data mapper implementation like Doctrine. So we know that the order repository needs a reference to a database connection, so we're going to have to create a mock database connection. When we ask for the stuff back from the database, it's going to return just a result set from the database, which aren't orders. It's just an array, like an array of associative arrays. So we're going to need some sort of mapper class that can map that array of arrays into like actual order objects. We're going to need a customer to pass in to retrieve the open orders for, and then we're going to need an actual collection of these open orders. So we'll just create a fake order and stick it into an array. And then when we ask the database for the results, we need to get something back from that that we can pass to the mapper. So we'll create a mock database results object. And now we're going to say that our database should receive the table method, you know, with the order string, where null, date shipped, get, and return the mock database results. And our order mapper should receive this map from database method. We think that's probably the way we're going to do it, with the mockDB results that came back from the database, and then return the open orders. So we're going to instantiate this new order repository, pass in the database connection, pass in the order mapper, and make sure that the, when we ask it for open orders for a specific customer, it gives us back what we expected. So the implementation looks something like this. Get open orders for customer, takes a customer, we get the ID from the customer. Then we make this call to the database, right, to get the result set back. We ask the order mapper to map that result set into actual order objects for us, and we return those orders. But we're not done yet because we have to implement these other classes. So we're going to write a test for our order mapper now to prove that it can actually map orders correctly. So we set up some kind of stubbed database results. This is what the data would look like coming back from the database. Here we would set up a bunch of expected orders that they would be converted to, but there's no room on the slide, so just imagine that they're there. And then we'll instantiate a new order mapper, ask it to map those database results, and then just make sure that the orders that come back are, you know, what we expect. And the implementation looks something like this. Map from database, take some database results. We loop over those database results and map each one individually into a collection object or into an array and just pass that back. And then that map from database, or that map individual row, right, the map database row call, looks something like this. So it just takes the row and it just kind of goes over that row and maps every type into the correct field the way we want it. So it converts the date columns to datetime objects. The payment method is going to be taken from maybe an integer or something and converted into a payment method object. And then we're going to return that order back. And now to set all this stuff up so we can actually get the customer's open orders in our application might look something like this. We create a new database connection with our credentials. We create a new customer mapper object because we need to get customer too to be able to pass that customer into the order repository to get his open orders. We ask the customer repository, well, we create the customer repository with the database connection and the mapper. We ask the customer repository to get us the customer with the ID of one. We create a new order mapper, pass our existing database connection and the order mapper into our new order repository, then ask the order repository to retrieve the open orders for that customer, and now we've got the open orders. Cool, right? And we did all that work just because this method, customer get open orders, was too hard to test in isolation, in complete isolation. So despite the fact that this was easy to understand and intuitive to use, because it wasn't easy to test, we totally altered our design and went on a different path to try and make it easier to test in isolation. So we're trading off two of the things that we value in favor of just one of them. So what's the solution to this? Again, for the love of God, use real collaborators. So if we wanted to test that active record implementation, We could just spin up an in-memory SQLite database, which frameworks like Laravel make really easy to do, and write a test that looks something more like this. Create a new customer, create two orders that do have a shipped date, and we'll call those shipped orders, and an order that hasn't been shipped, and then we're just gonna save those using the methods provided to us by our ORM into the customer's order relationship, and then we're just gonna ask the customer for its open orders and make sure that those open orders do contain the unshipped order and don't contain the shipped order. This is like a really, really clear test. This is like actually proving that when I ask the customer for his open orders, I actually get orders back that I've determined are open and not closed orders. So it's not a unit test, maybe by the classic definition of a unit test. A lot of people would say this is more of a functional test, but this actually tests something, and it's easier for us to understand and lets us write the code that we think is easier and more fun to use, right? And it's also more resilient to refactoring. So nowhere in this test does it say it should call the table method on the database connection and then call a where method with a date unshipped equals null and all this stuff. We can change how any of that stuff works, and this test will still provide value for us. And like Martin Fowler, you know, one of the disciples of object-oriented design, actually said in a recent article about unit tests that if talking to the database is stable and fast, then there's no reason not to do it in your unit tests. So he's talking about talking to a database in a test and still calling it a unit test. So if Martin Fowler thinks it's okay, then I definitely think it's okay.
Can I stop you for a second?
Yeah.
A collaborator is a real object in a real system. Is that what a collaborator is?
A collaborator is just any other object that the object you're testing needs to communicate with in any way.
Because it seems like the problem with the open orders is that you need your system so that you have it to test your open order.
Yeah, so the test is... Yeah, I mean, in
the,
so in the method that I walked through, you mean, like the more data mapper style approach? So the test that I just showed you is basically we're accepting the fact that we're leveraging the power that we get from the ORM that comes with our framework and just writing a test that lets us test what we want without sacrificing the functionality that we get from the ORM. So our test is dependent on the ORM and it's dependent on the database. So it's a trade-off that you're making on whether you want your tests to be coupled to the underlying ORM that you're using underneath it, or whether you want your tests to work in any framework with any ORM and you want to roll your own thing and you don't want to have to set up any of this infrastructure like the database or anything like
what
that.
What I'm confused is I'm looking at you setting things up and I don't know whether that's the real e-commerce system or something that's solely done for the test.
So in the one slide where I was talking about bootstrapping those collaborators, that's basically what you'd have to do in your real application, but it would happen in not as ugly of a one-page way, right? You'd be setting that stuff up with service providers through like your dependency injection container and stuff like that. So it wouldn't look that dirty, but you'd still have to do all that setup. So anyways, I just want to finish this talk off with the fact that testing is an art, right? It takes a lot of practice and it takes a lot of time and effort put into it. What I was looking for when I was first getting into testing was this kind of like magic checklist that I could just put in front of me when I was writing a test and be like, okay, I got to stub out the collaborators, I got to mock out the database, and as long as I follow all these rules, I'm going to end up with perfect tests and a perfectly designed system, and everything's just going to work. But the reality is there's not like one right way to design things or one right way to test things. So anytime you're choosing a design or choosing to use a more functional test over a unit test, it's based on the knowledge that you have of your system at that time, how you expect it to change, and that's nothing that a list of rules can provide for you. I'm not saying that you should never use real collaborators, that you should never use test doubles. Test doubles are super, super, super valuable tools, and you need to use them a lot. What I'm saying is that you shouldn't have to use them all the time, and that there's a lot of situations where it makes more sense to use real objects instead of using the test doubles. I found that the best way for me to get into testing was to stop being intimidated by this idea that to write tests at all, I had to write perfect tests and I had to design things perfectly. If Uncle Bob and Kent Beck and Martin Fowler are over here on this spectrum of like, we've got it all figured out, we're the best programmers in the world, and someone who's never programmed at all is here, it's not like a black and white thing. It's not like this is you know it and this is you don't know it. It's a journey, right? And you're allowed to be somewhere in between, and you shouldn't have to not test just because you're not there yet. So these kind of strategies that I've been talking about are things that I used to help me write tests that delivered value for me along the way while I'm getting better at object-oriented design, while I'm getting better at writing the right tests. And the best way to do that for me was just to think about, like, you know, how can I write a test that proves that the thing I'm about to write works? And maybe the way that it proves it to me is different than the way it proves it to you. But you're not writing tests to impress anyone. You're writing tests so that you can deploy stuff to production at the end of the day and go home and feel totally fine. I've worked on a lot of projects in the past where anytime we made a change or implemented a new feature, deploying to production, everyone was like biting their nails and just like, please fucking work, please, please work, right? You have no idea because you don't have a test suite that, you either don't have a test suite or you don't have a test suite that you're confident in.
Yeah.
So the end goal of writing these tests is to have something that gives you that confidence, that proves to you that your system is working the way you want it to. As long as you feel like when you see that green bar that your system is good, it doesn't matter what type of tests you wrote or how you wrote those tests. That's the goal. That's what you're thinking of the whole time. And thinking about things in that way and not being afraid to use the database and not being afraid to, you know, set up stuff in the database and set up the world the way I want it so I can test something. Thinking about doing things that way just made it a lot easier for me. Like, ultimately, at the end of the day, if I couldn't figure out how to write, like, this nice, decoupled, perfectly isolated test, I would just write the same code in the test that I was writing in the application, and I would just check that after it was done, the system was in the state that I wanted it to be in. And it might be an ugly test, and it might not have helped me improve my design, but at least I have a test now, and at least I know that when I run that test and it passes, that my system works the way I expected it to. So that's everything I got. If you want to follow me on Twitter, I'm Adam Lavin on Twitter, and I blog about object-oriented design and like modern PHP development and testing and stuff fairly frequently at my website, adamlavin.me. So, yeah, that's great.